I hope you're understanding now. I know you know it, but it's certainly been our emphasis as we've been especially marching through this Sermon on the Mount, but in all of Jesus' teaching. Jesus is not giving us commands. We looked at one, you know, last week. Don't worry. That will be one of those 1,050 commands, maybe several times. You can't keep that. We're going to look at one today. You can't keep, I promise you. But Jesus is laying down for us principles. He's setting out the ideal, but it's all about our invitation into the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, and what it looks like to be a citizen of that kingdom as the Holy Spirit moves us day by day in the direction of this ideal. Now, we can't keep 1,050 commands, but we can do that, right? We can become more like Jesus, step by step, by the power of the Holy Spirit, not by our own power, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that's what this is all about. That's why I keep coming back to, you know, there's two commandments. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. We could say three. Love your brothers and sisters in Christ the way Jesus loved you. That's John 14. If we do those things, Jesus says all the law and the prophet hangs on that anyway. And that 1,050 will not be such an ominous number. So what does it mean to be a citizen in the kingdom? These are the things that you need to be working toward, these principles. So we go back to the Sermon on the Mount, and I'm going to backtrack just a little bit on because we didn't quite finish with the worrying part of it, but we're almost finished. But I'm going to just review it really, really quickly and no detail. The text says, "Why do you worry about clothes? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all of his splendor was dressed like one of these. And if that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, and what shall we wear? For the pagans, the Gentiles, the unbelievers, the idolaters run after these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you." And there's the principle rolled up in a neat little ball for you. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart is going to be. "Therefore, take no thought, do not worry or be anxious or be concerned about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." And then we mentioned a few ways to kind of help us to mature this principle, to grow in this principle. We said, surrender your worries to God, trust him to be faithful, stay in the present moment, worry is about the future. Talk to God, tell him what you need. And then number four, listen to God. Meditation has not been one of our strong emphasis in our Church of Christ tradition, or at least in mine. It's not something we talked about, or if we did, we just kind of cast it aside as what those New Age people do. And so it probably is not something that we should do. It's probably, and maybe it's even dangerous, who knows. I find that unfortunate. I've talked about centering prayer a few times, and I won't dwell on this, but I'll just remind you of it. Centering prayer is a method of silent prayer that prepares us to receive the gift of contemplative prayer in which we experience God's presence within us, closer than breathing, closer than thinking, closer than consciousness itself. This method of prayer is both a relationship with God and a discipline to foster that relationship. This is something I've discovered a few years ago now, and I have found it extremely helpful. And The picture you see there is the logo that you will see if you go in your app on your phone and put in centering prayer. You'll see that logo, and if you download that, it has more than you ever need to know about what it is and how to do it. And it's a neat, neat tool if you want to experience centering prayer. And basically, you know, have you ever known somebody that when you are in conversation with them, it's a one-way conversation, you listen, and you know, we say we can't get a word in edgewise. That gets a little bit tiresome, doesn't it, after a while? So if all we do in prayer is just jabber at God all the time, do you think that might tend to be a one-way conversation? What if we took time to just be quiet? John of the Cross, one of the early church fathers said, desert fathers actually, said, God's language is silence. And I've got a whole sheet of scriptural references that bear that out. Be still and know that I am God. And I think there's great value and great power in learning to control your mind in a way that quiets it to where you can actually just be present with God in the moment. And there's a certain skill to doing that. And I won't go into all of that now, but it's all spelled out in the app if you want to look at it. But it doesn't take a lot of time, but it's time really well spent. And I just wanted to share that with you again. I know I've mentioned it before, but it's I think that if you take the time to get past the initial frustration, because telling your mind to sit down and shut up, your mind doesn't want to. Your mind wants to keep churning all the time on what it wants to think about. And for us to take control of that and to actually get to a point where we are in communication with the subconscious rather than that conscious chatter all the time, it takes some exercise, it takes some intentionality, and it takes a little bit of skill. But it's worth the effort. Highly recommend it. All right. James 5:13, are any of you suffering hardships? You should pray. Are any of you happy? You should sing praise. I wanted to close out this discussion on worry with one more song. And some of you will remember this from, I don't know when it was, maybe back in the 80s or 90s, I'm not sure. But This will you'll be humming this the rest
Here's
of the day.
Here's a little song I wrote. You might want to sing it note for note. Don't worry, be happy. In every life we have some trouble, but when you worry you make it double. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. No place to lay your head. Somebody came and took your bed. Don't worry, be happy. The landlord say your rent is late. He may have to litigate. Don't worry, be happy.
Look at me, I'm happy.
Don't worry, be happy. Hey, I give you my phone number. When you worry, call me. I make you happy. Don't worry. Be happy. Ain't got no cash, ain't got no style, ain't got no gal to make you smile, but don't worry, be happy. Cause when you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
How many remember that? I can't remember exactly when it was. It was back in the 80s or 90s, I guess, maybe. A real popular hit for a while. All right, so much for worrying. We're going to move on. Another law to keep. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged, for you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. How many of you have ever passed judgment on anyone else for anything? How many of you have done it this morning? How many of you will do it a few more times before you leave the building today? Shame on you. You can't go to heaven if you pass judgment. Bunch of goats. Well, what in the world are you talking about, Jesus, giving us these commands that there's no way we're going to keep? In fact, they don't even make sense in terms of other things, do they? So what is he talking about? Do not judge others, but you be not judged. That you be not judged. I think our first thought when we read that, or at least maybe mine was, is that if I judge you, God's going to judge me. And whatever standard I use to judge you, that's the standard God's going to use to judge me. And I'm not saying that's not correct. I think there's some issues with that. But it's also this simple law of giving and receiving, doing unto others as you would have them do unto you, and reaping what you sow, right? If I'm a judgmental person all the time, then you are going to be more prone to pass judgment on me. So it's not just a matter of a relationship that exists between God and myself. The law to not judge is pretty clearly spelled out in a number of places. Luke 6:37, do not judge and you will not be judged. Do not condemn and you will not be condemned. Forgive and you will be forgiven. Luke 6:41, why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye but fail to notice the beam in your own eye? We'll come back to that later. John 8:30 and John 8:7, when they continued to question him, he straightened up and said to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to cast a stone at her. Don't judge. Romans 2:1, you therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on another. For whatever grounds you judge the other, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things. Romans 14:10. Why then do you judge your brother, or why do you belittle your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. Romans 14:13. Therefore, let us stop judging one another. Instead, Make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in your brother's way. Pretty clear, isn't it? Pretty repetitive, pretty muchly emphasized. 1 Corinthians 4 and 5, therefore judge nothing before the appointed time. Wait until the Lord comes. He will bring light, bring to light what is hidden in darkness and will expose the motives of men's hearts. At that time, each will receive his praise from God. In James 4, 11, brothers and sisters, do not slander one another. Anyone who speaks against a brother or sister or judges them, or judges them, or judges them, or judges them, speaks against the law and judges it. When you judge the law, you're not keeping it, but sitting in judgment of it. What does the scripture say about judging? Don't do it. Don't do it. On the other hand, there's always on the other hand, right? John 7:24, stop judging by mere appearances, but what? And judge how? Correctly. Jesus, you just told us not to judge. Now you're telling us to judge correctly. 1 Corinthians 5 and 12, what business of mine is it to judge those outside the church? Are you not to judge those inside? God will judge those outside. Well, what are you doing judging them inside? He just said don't judge. 1 Corinthians 2 and 15, the spiritual person judges all things, but is himself to be judged by no one. Romans 12 and 9, don't just pretend to love others, really love them. Hate what is wrong. How can you hate what is wrong if you don't pass judgment? How can you do it? Hold tightly to what is good. 1 Corinthians 6 and 2, or do you not know that the Lord's people, what? Will judge the world. And if you are to judge the world, are you not competent to judge trivial cases? Do you not know that we will judge angels? I don't know what that means. David, can you explain that? No, me either. How much more the things of this life? So there is another hand, isn't there? James 5:19, my dear brothers and sisters, if someone among you wanders away from the truth and is brought back, you can be sure that whoever brings the sinner back from the wandering will save that person from death and bring about the forgiveness of many sins. How do you determine if somebody has wandered from the truth? You pass judgment on them, don't you? It's the only way you can get there from here. Jesus continually judged the religious leaders and told his followers to watch out for or to judge false teachers. We can understand why Jesus would do it, because he would judge perfectly, right? But he also instructs his followers to watch out for false teachers. Paul and Peter, of course, often passed judgment on people who were standing in the way of their ministry. From the Old Testament, Zechariah 8 and verse 16, these are the things which you shall do. Speak the truth to one another. Judge with truth and judgment for peace at your gates. So how do we reconcile this conundrum of judging or not judging? Do we not, as a matter of duty, judge others every day? If we're on a jury, we're compelled to pass a judgment, to create a verdict. Anytime you have people working for you and they become an invaluable employee, you pass judgment on them, and maybe you terminate them. Elders are required to enforce discipline in the church. We pretty much stopped doing that in our culture now, but that doesn't mean that it's not incumbent upon us to do that. We have to remember that our Lord is not writing new law, but rather giving principles that describe what being a kingdom citizen embodies. Principle is a rule which, because it cannot be kept to the letter, forces us back to the spirit. So what is the answer to this conundrum? The answer is that there is a principle here that we need to observe in spirit. We need to be cautious about how and who and what we judge, and do it in accordance with the principle that God has laid down. A little bit of information now on how we can kind of determine when we're doing it that way, when we're being conscious of the spirit, not of a detrimental, judgmental attitude. You know the word censorious from the word censor, expressing censure, inclined to find fault, harshly critical. You know that person, don't you? You know that person who is continually looking for the bad. What's wrong? They're usually a very negative person to begin with. Their first response to everything is no. They're identifiable, and they're not usually the very best of company. They're not usually the first person we seek out when we have a need for help or want to find a friend, the person who is censorious. What is forbidden is the censorious, judging temper, eager to find faults and condemn men for them, men or women for them, suspicious of motives and denouncing the faintest shade of heresy. No mere rules can guide us to the limits of our judgments. What we need is to have our senses exercised to discern between good and evil, to cultivate the sensitiveness of conscience and the clearness of self-knowledge. I'm taking this from a commentary. You'll recognize that's not my writing, but I thought it was very good. It's from Elcott's. He says, judge no person unless it be a duty to do so. Now, that's a pretty good rule of thumb. There's a time when we need to pass judgment, right? There's a time when somebody is doing things that are going to really have a very negative, bad effect. And we need to recognize that. We need to pass judgment on that. We need to try to correct that. But we need to be able to understand when that's the case, not as just somebody who doesn't agree with me or somebody whose actions or thoughts I don't particularly care for. That's a different thing. As far as may be, judge the offense, not the offender. And that's a pretty good rule of thumb. The thing that you're judging is not the person, but some particular action that needs to be confronted. Confine your judgment to the earthly side of faults and leave their relation to God, to him who sees the heart. And that's something that I think that we as Christians in a church environment have a tendency to do. We want to pass judgment on your relationship with God because you're not doing things the way that I do them. And we need to get down off of the judgment seat and let God rule and let him make those decisions. That was one of the most liberating times of my life. I can almost put it on a calendar when I decided to get down off of the judgment of God's judgment seat and let him do it. Turns out he does it better than I did. I recommend it. Never judge at all without remembering your own sinfulness and the ignorance and infirmities which may extenuate the sinfulness of others. You don't know what's going on in that person's life. You don't know what prompted that particular action at that particular time, or those words at that particular time. God knows, but you don't. It may even be that that person doesn't fully understand. So those are some good guidelines, if you will, on how we can begin to live up to this principle of not judging in a world in which we are called to judge. Here's another thing that I borrowed from my friend, Chat AI. When Jesus says, judge not, he is cautioning against a particular kind of judgment that is characterized by a self-righteous and condemnatory attitude. He discourages the tendency to make harsh and unfounded judgments about others, assuming a position of moral superiority. If we just stop there, that would be pretty helpful, because so many times our judgment comes from an attitude of, I'm better than you are. I know more perfectly how to act and behave than you do, so I have the right to judge you. This form of judgment involves a critical and fault-finding mindset that fails to consider one's own shortcomings and lacks empathy for the person being judged. Jesus' statement serves as a reminder to approach others with humility, empathy, and self-reflection. The last thing we want to do when we're trying to pass judgment on somebody. It urges individuals to refrain from passing hasty and unfair judgments, instead fostering a culture of compassion and understanding. By doing so, Jesus envisions a society built on love and respect, where individuals strive to uplift and support one another rather than tearing each other down through harsh criticism and condemnation. By exploring the historical, theological, and ethical dimensions of Jesus' statement, "Judge not that you be not judged," we come to realize its significance for personal morality, interpersonal relationships, and the development of a just and compassionate society. A just and compassionate family. What about your own personal family, if you have these kind of attitudes? And a just and compassionate congregation, if we have these kind of attitudes. Forgive others and you will be forgiven. Again, when we read that, our first thought is, or mine anyway, is that if I forgive you, then God's going to forgive me. And I know God, I need God to forgive me. So I need to forgive you. But is that really right? Are we really obligating God to forgive us when we forgive each other? Or is this a principle that declares that the forgiving person is more apt to be forgiven by people that he or she offends? In the very base of things, at the very core of things, God has already offered us full forgiveness. He did that when he allowed his son to go to the cross for us. We appropriate that forgiveness through our faithfulness to Christ. I think that maybe the forgiveness here is more in line with, I want you to forgive me, rather than by me doing this, I'm making God responsible for forgiving me. He's already done that. That work was already done. I'm not saying that the other, maybe, I don't know. If you want to accept it as obligating God, well, I don't have any argument with that, but I think that this is probably more appropriate. Given, you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back. This is going to open up a whole new can of worms. Does Jesus here in this statement obligate God to reward you financially in proportion to the amount that you give to him? There is a huge movement, has been for many years, that deals with this idea. And we're going to spend a little bit of time. We're going to camp on it a little bit because I think it's important to discuss. But this statement, taken by itself, with no other context, creates some real problems for us. It creates a real conundrum for us. It says that if you give, God is obligated, and we're going to see further in a little bit, that it not only to give back to you equally, but how much? 100-fold. You're going to get rich. You bring your tithe to the church, and you're going to get rich. You send your tithe to me so I can preach over the radio to you, and you're going to get rich. And of course, I'm going to get richer, but... But you see what we get into when we take a verse and make a theology out of a verse? And we do it all the time. But that's what it says. There's no other way to read that. And that creates some real questions for us. That says, if I'm not getting rich, God's not keeping his end of the bargain. I put my tithe in. What's happening here? It's called prosperity theology. You heard of it? Prosperity gospel is a religious belief among some Protestant Christians that financial blessing and physical well-being are always the will of God for them, and that faith, positive speech, and donations to religious causes will increase one's material wealth. It is also referred to as a health and wealth gospel, or the name it and claim it gospel. It's most prominent among the charismatic movements. I have friends who very sincerely believe this, and can't understand how everybody doesn't believe it. The only reason you're poor, the only reason you're struggling, is because you're not being generous enough with God. That's what I said, right? Well, there's basis for it. There's scripture for it. One of my friends sent me a list, I don't know, probably 100 scriptures testifying to this prosperity theology. Malachi 3:10 is one of the favorite ones. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, God says. Test me. And see if I do not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room to store it. I will prevent pests from devouring your crops, and the vines in your fields will not drop their fruit before it's ripe, says the Lord Almighty. Test me, God says. You give it to me, and I'll make you rich. Are you rich? Well, most of us are, but what if you're not? What if you're in Africa? What if you're in India, or and you're resorting to mud cakes to stay alive? That mean God doesn't love you? Mark 10:28, Peter spoke up. We have left everything to follow you. Truly I tell you, Jesus replied, no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. We're not talking about apple pie in the sky by and by. We're talking about now. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children and fields, along with persecutions and in the age to come, eternal life. I put $10 in the collection plate. God owes me what? What is 100-fold of 10? Somebody do math. Pretty good return on investment. Parable of the talents, Matthew 25. Man given five talents, went out and put it to usury and made five more. Jesus said, well, the master says, well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I'll make you master over many things. Prosperity. John 10:10. I am come that they might have life. They might have it more abundantly. Abundantly. Philippians 4:19. My God shall supply all you need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. 3 John 1:2, beloved, I wish above all things that you may prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers. Prosperity theology. Become a Christian. Get rich. On the other hand, there's always on the other hand. John 6:26, Jesus answered, very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food for that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life. Which the Son of Man will give you. Rich young man comes to Jesus and says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And what did Jesus say? Well, give me 10% and I'll give you 100%. Nope. He says, sell all you got. Give it to the poor. Come follow me. And Jesus was so prosperous in life that he didn't even have anywhere to lay his head. The birds have nests, the foxes have dens. The Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Well, they're coming in. I see my wife coming in. My birthday girl's coming in. And so we're going to leave off here, and we'll pick this up next week, Lord willing, and we'll try to sort out this idea of prosperity. Thanks for your attention. Have a wonderful, God bless week.
Thank you, Randy.